This is Audible.
Bad Things, Tristan and Danica, Volume 1. Written by R.K. Lilly. Narrated by Sarah Naughton and Chris Ruin at Brickshop Audio, Inc. This book is dedicated to all of those who have gone through the utter heartbreak of watching a loved one suffer the disease of addiction. It is the most helpless feeling in the world. My heart goes out to you. Danica hasn't had an easy life. Being insanely attracted to bad boys has never helped make it easier. One look at Tristan, and every brain cell she possessed went up in smoke. This man was trouble with a capital T. It was a given. She knew better. Bad boys were bad, especially for her. Considering her history, it was crazy to think otherwise. So why did crazy have to feel so damn fine? For as long as she could remember, Danica had been focused on the future with single-minded purpose. Tristan came along and taught her everything there was to know about letting go and living in the present. She fell, hard and deep. Of course, that only made her impact with the ground that much more devastating. Bad Things is about Tristan and Danica and their train wreck of a love story. This series can be read as a standalone or with the Up in the Air trilogy. Bad Things is a full-length novel at roughly 105,000 words. This book is intended for ages 18 and up. Chapter 1. The Beginning. Danica. I had the strangest shiver of premonition rock my body the first time I heard Tristan's voice. I heard it from a room away as he said something offhanded to my boss, Jerry, and still I knew somehow that he would change my life. I had an unruly armful of clean laundry and five dogs crowding my legs in my boss's cramped laundry room when I heard the front door open and two men chatting as they entered the house. I wasn't alarmed. It was a chaotic sort of house, with all sorts of people coming and going at all hours of the day, and I recognized the sound of Jerry's voice instantly. The other man that spoke was a stranger, but his voice was deep, and it sort of rumbled through the house until it reached me. I had an instant and positive reaction to it. I had mixed feelings about men in general, having a rather sordid past with them as a whole, and having recently gone through a nasty breakup with a real piece of work. My ex had been an out-of-work, pothead loser, and he hadn't been the first loser that I'd wasted my time on. Still, I knew right away that I adored the sound of that deep, masculine voice. I dropped the pile of clothes into the clean laundry pile in the clean corner of the room. My laundry skills were negligible, to put it nicely. I worked for Jerry and his ex-wife, Beverly, as a live-in nanny slash housekeeper slash dog walker slash pool girl slash gardener slash whatever they needed me to do. It was well understood that I pretty much sucked at the housekeeper part of that arrangement, but it seemed to work for us all. I'd been working for them for 2 years, and we were going strong. Beverly and Jerry, dysfunctional exes and awesome co-parents that they were, had become my closest friends and two of my favorite people on the planet. I was dressed like a slob in two short black cheer shorts and a washed-out gray UNLV sweatshirt, my straight black hair pulled into a rough ponytail, and not wearing a scrap of makeup. But I went to meet the newcomer anyway. My five favorite animals on the planet dogged my steps as I padded down the hallway. Jerry's back was to me as I turned the corner from the hallway and into the black, stone-lined entryway, the stranger facing me. I saw at a glance that the stranger was young, sexy as hell, and straight up trouble with a capital T. I knew trouble when I saw it, it being a very old friend of mine. Trouble for me was this nasty little self-destructive streak that I'd never quite been able to shake. A theme song even played in my head when I felt the big T getting close. Four Kicks was that song, and it cranked up to full volume with my first glance at him. He was tall, and built like a linebacker, both muscular and massive. He wore a tight black t-shirt that showcased every starkly muscled inch of his chest. His tattooed arms were folded across his chest in a casually attentive stance, but his presence commanded the room. His face was handsome, with clean, even features that were dominated by pale golden eyes. He had a straight slash of a nose with a rounded tip that would have brought him from handsome to pretty boy if he wasn't so damned big, and full lips on a wide mouth that popped killer dimples at me as it hitched up playfully. Those dimples were pure Big T. His pitch black hair was cropped short, with dark stubble lining his jaw. His easy smile was playful, but still managed to be sinister. It was a heady combination for someone who was on a first-name basis with the Big T. Jerry turned to see what the other man was smiling about. He was a middle-aged man, short and balding, with a slight build. His face was far from handsome, with close-set eyes and a big nose, but I thought he had one of the best smiles in the world.
"Danica,"
Jerry said with that world-class smile.
"This is my buddy Tristan. He's going to be crashing on the couch for a few days. He's, between residences."
I mentally groaned. Bev was going to kill him. One glance at Tristan and I knew he wasn't just a buddy. Jerry had a spotty history with helping out what he always thought was the latest rising star. He had big dreams of managing the next big rock band, and he took those dreams to extremes. He and Bev were both technically attorneys, but she was the only lawyer in the house that you could call employed. Jerry was too busy collecting unsigned bands to practice law.
I gave Jerry a pointed look. "Bev is going to string you up. She said that if you brought home one more out-of-work musician, that she was going to kick you out, and then I would get upgraded to a bigger room."
He grimaced.
Now, don't go jumping to conclusions. Tristan has a job. Look, he's not even carrying a guitar."
I eyed Tristan up.
"What's the job?"
Jerry answered for him, which let me know that he was full of it.
"He's a club promoter."
I rolled my eyes.
"Is that the best you can do? That's Vegas code for unemployed, Jerry. My pothead ex-boyfriend even calls himself a club promoter, and I don't think he ever even leaves his house. You need to think up something better before Bev gets home."
Tristan laughed, not looking even slightly offended by our exchange.
"I am a club promoter, and I do also happen to be in a band,"
he said in a low, sexy drawl.
Oh, Lord, I thought.
Four kicks by Kings of Leon playing at full volume in my head as I heard his voice at close range. And I tried to pretend that I hadn't even heard that sexy-as-hell laugh. I knew that we were going to be a dangerous combination. Bad things were going to happen if we spent too much time around each other.
"Don't let Bev hear you say that,"
I warned him. I was really just trying to help Jerry out. I didn't want him to get into trouble with Bev again, and he never seemed to have a clue just what would set her off, even though it was always very obvious to me. I sighed, knowing that this wouldn't be easy to fix. I tensed as I heard the loud garage door opening across the house. Bev's house was a huge, rambling, ranch-style house, but the garage door was so loud that it always announced her presence. I gave Jerry a stern look, sometimes feeling like his mother, even though he was 45 and I was barely 21. I pointed at him.
"I know what we need to do, but you're going to owe me. I hate lying to Bev."
It was true. I was nowhere near nonchalant about the deception I was about to undergo, and I wanted him to know it. Beverly was my hero. No one had ever helped me as much or been as supportive of me as she had. Plus, I just liked her. She was my closest friend, and I developed a serious case of hero worship for the successful 48-year-old woman.
"Tristan is a friend of mine," I told them. "Do not mention the words club promoter or band. He is a plain old out-of-work student and crashing for 1 week on the couch. We met at UNLV last semester. Got it?"
Jerry nodded, giving me a grateful smile.
"You're the best, Danica. I owe you."
He sure did. I looked at Tristan,
He was giving me that playful smile of his, as though we hadn't just barely met.
"You're a sassy little thing. I like that," he murmured.
Just as Bev and her boys rounded the corner that led from the garage and into the main living area, Ivan and Matt caught sight of me and the dogs swarming at my heels and rushed me with huge whoops. Ivan was an unabashedly diabolical 8-year-old, and Matt was a precocious 6-year-old, and the two of them combined were more than a handful, but I loved them to pieces. Matt went straight for a tackle to my midsection, while Ivan caught the biggest dog, Mango, in a bear hug. Mango was a tan-colored bloodhound. She was 9 years old and left a trail of slobber in her wake. She was a terrible guard dog. We were all convinced that if the place was robbed, she'd just see it as an opportunity to lick more faces. Matt squeezed my waist so hard that he drew a little grunt out of me. The second biggest dog, Dot, took exception to the rough handling. He growled menacingly at the 6-year-old. He was a big black Belgian shepherd, and none of us had any doubts that he was a good guard dog. A little too good, in fact. He'd taken to being my own personal protector, even against the other inhabitants of the house, and that included the boys. I shushed Dot, hugging Matt back. He was a skinny blonde kid with gorgeous blue eyes.
"You said you'd make us cookies when we got back,"
Matt told me excitedly. I nodded. "Okay, you gonna help me make them, or you wanna go play while I cook?"
"Play!"
he shouted. I didn't know if it was Matt, or being 6, but the boy had a serious volume control issue. It just made me laugh.
"Okay, I bet you'll be able to smell them when they're done."
"Yes!"
he shouted, even louder, then took off for his room. Ivan straightened, looking around at all of the adults and pursing his lips. He had light brown hair, was tall for his age, and had soft brown eyes like his dad. He was a funny kid. He had moments of being a shameless brat, but just as many moments of absolute charm.
"I want to play too, Danica, but I'll help you if you really, really need me to."
I smiled at him.
"I got it covered, buddy. You go on and play."
He took off, never saying a word to his dad or to Tristan. Typical 8-year-old, only paying attention to the one making cookies. Beverly and I shared a look. She gave her boys a laughing eye roll before heading the same way they'd gone, towards her bedroom. She barely spared Tristan a glance. It wasn't a good sign.
"Jerry, a word?"
she called out, still moving toward her room. It didn't bode well. He swore under his breath, but followed her. I headed over to the kitchen. I felt Tristan following me. The house was set up with an open floor plan. It was huge, but the entryway, living room, dining room, kitchen, and family room all shared one massive space, so it was a straight shot into the kitchen once I got around the giant L-shaped sofa that dominated the living room. The house was a strange combination of shabby chic, leaning way further in the direction of shabby. Beverly was very successful as a workers' compensation attorney, and she came from a rich family, so money wasn't an issue when it came to the house. It was colossal, and in one of the nicest gated communities in Vegas. But the house was lined with outdoor carpeting, and the furniture was in desperate need of an update. The only saving grace in the house was the spectacular artwork that she collected. Words couldn't even express how much I appreciated her fine eye for upcoming artists. But they were the only saving grace when it came to the house's aesthetics. I understood why she didn't update a lot of it. New carpet would be ruined in just a few weeks by her unruly dogs and crazy kids. And the dark green leather sofa had the entire back gnawed off. I couldn't imagine a new sofa wouldn't receive the same treatment. I had to unlock the latch that had been installed on the side of the refrigerator before I opened it. Mango liked to eat sticks of butter when it wasn't latched tight. I pulled out a plastic tube that was filled with chocolate chip cookie dough. I heard a clear, disappointed groan behind me. I turned to look at Tristan, arching a brow at him. What? You don't like chocolate chip? He shook his head at me, still showing off one dangerous dimple in a half smile. I really wished he'd put those dimples away. They were counterproductive to my peace of mind.
You're joking, right?
He asked pointedly. I had no idea what he was talking about.
About what? Cookie dough out of a plastic tube? Pre-made?
I shrugged. It's easy and fast, and they taste fine. He shook his head again.
Show me to your baking supplies. I can't stand by and watch this.
I scowled at him.
You're bossy for an out-of-work house guest,
I told him.
I have a job. Several, actually. But, yeah, I'm bossy. Now show me to your flour.
I kept scowling, but I was walking from the kitchen and into the walk-in pantry while I did it. I waved a hand at the area that kind of held the baking supplies. The pantry was hardly well organized, so he would probably have to dig around to get everything he needed for cookies. I left him to it, going back into the kitchen to preheat the oven and grease a cookie sheet. I put out a large mixing bowl, measuring cups, and any other incidentals I thought he might need for baking. It was the least I could do if he was actually going to do the baking. I shrugged out of my sweatshirt, suddenly warm. It was 110 degrees outside, but you wouldn't know it by the way I normally froze inside of the AC'd to death house. It wasn't normal for me to get so warm inside for no reason at all. I was wearing a thin white tank and sitting on the counter when Tristan strolled back into the kitchen, his arms full of baking supplies. He set them on the counter near the mixing bowl, lining them up neatly. His biceps bulged with the smallest movement. It was fascinating. Salt? He asked me, his brow raised. I blinked, trying to process what he'd said. I pointed behind me after a few awkward moments. He moved towards me without a word, and I saw my folly then. The cupboard I'd pointed to was directly behind me. I should have just grabbed it for him. He didn't seem to mind, moving uncomfortably close to me to reach behind me. His upper chest got so close to my face that I could smell him. He smelled divine. So divine that I closed my eyes for a second to take it in. He had to reach up, so his hip grazed my inner thigh as he shamelessly moved between my legs to get closer. I gasped. "Sorry," he said, backing up, the salt in his hand. I saw his eyes flick briefly down my body before he turned away, setting the salt beside the other ingredients.
"So you're the nanny, huh? You are not what I pictured when Jerry said he had a live-in nanny."
I glared at his back.
"What did you picture?" "I don't really know. I didn't have a clear picture in my head. I just wasn't expecting someone like you."
He turned his head to flick me another unreadable glance. I gave him a very unfriendly look, offended, and a little wounded.
"What is that supposed to mean?"
"Nothing bad. Quit giving me evil eyes. Nannies just don't usually look like you. You're like what Hollywood would cast to be a nanny to add sex appeal to a movie.
You're sexy. Really sexy. Don't play coy. You know you're gorgeous."
I stopped glaring, but I was wary of the compliments.
"Relax, okay?"
he said, studying my face.
"I'm not hitting on you, and I won't. What are you, like 18? Way too young for me. I'm just stating facts. Normally women don't appreciate other women as hot as you underfoot."
I was glaring again. "I'm 21, and Bev is my best friend. I've been working for them for 2 years. He threw up his hands, giving me an apologetic smile.
"Sorry. I'm not trying to be a dick. It just surprised me that you were the nanny Jerry was telling me about. It gave me no hints that you were, well, hot."
"How old are you?" I asked him, still smarting from the too young comment.
26.
"That's not that old," I told him.
"I know. Just too old to be dating 18-year-olds. Or even 21-year-olds. Frankly, though, I'm bad with women my own age, too, when it comes to relationships, which is why I don't do them."
I couldn't help it. I had to ask. So, what do you do?
Hookups. Brief, casual hookups. How about you?
I shook my head, pursing my lips at him. I couldn't quite believe that we had jumped to this already. He was a man to be careful of, to be sure.
I do relationships, no exceptions. Never had a casual hookup in my life.
He sighed, measuring some flour into the mixing bowl.
Well, I guess that makes things less complicated. We'll be friends then.
He shot me a sidelong smile that was downright irresistible. I thought this was one of the strangest conversations I'd ever had, being that we had just met. Only, it didn't feel like we had just met. He spoke to me like he'd known me forever, and it was hard to refuse anything he said in that low voice of his. I nodded, giving him my own, rather begrudging smile.
Okay, friends. Since we'll be living under the same roof for the next week.
Okay, then. My first job as your friend will be to show you how to make the best chocolate chip cookies in the world.
Chapter 2. Tristan walked me through every step of the cookie-making process, and I pretended to pay attention. But that attention kept wandering to his spectacular arms while he worked. I barely kept my composure when he used the mixer, and I watched his ripped arms vibrate with the movement of it.
Did you catch that, Danica?
He asked me with a smile. I shook myself out of it, looking at his face.
Huh?
He shook his head at me, his smile widening. I found my eyes focusing on the shadow of a beard lining his jaw. I'd never found the unshaven look so attractive before.
You're a little troublemaker,
he told me, matter-of-factly, going back to his cookie dough.
Me?
I asked, and I wasn't sad when he didn't respond. We didn't need to get into a conversation about trouble. He spooned little balls of his dough onto the cookie sheet very precisely. He slid the pan into the oven, setting the timer.
Do you like to go out?
He asked me as he washed up. I couldn't seem to take my eyes off his hands.
Go out?
He dried them off and approached me, stopping just short of my legs.
Yeah, go out. Like to bars and clubs and parties? What do you like to do for fun?
I opened my mouth to answer, but my mind was pretty blank. Fun, what did I do for fun? I kept busy, that was for sure. But was any of it strictly for fun?
I swim with the boys a lot, and I walk the dogs.
He blinked at me, and I wanted to smack my own forehead. I sounded like a weirdo, even to myself.
You swim with the boys and walk the dogs? When was the last time you went out?
I mulled that over, quickly coming to the conclusion that I would not admit how long it had been since I'd gone out. I was saved from having to even attempt to answer by the swarm of dogs that invaded the kitchen. They had all followed Bev into her room, but had apparently finished saying their hellos. Dot moved between Tristan and me, letting out a little warning growl and taking his place to guard me. Tristan studied the dogs, his hands moving to his hips as he took them in.
Are you going to introduce me?
He asked. I couldn't help it. My lip curled at him in a smirk.
You want me to introduce you to the dogs?
He shrugged, that easy smile of his in place.
If you don't mind.
I pointed to Mango first.
That's Mango. She'll slobber on you and get on top of you when you're sleeping, but she's the sweetest dog in the world.
He nodded, moving to stroke his hands over the big dog. She was putty in his hands. I pointed to the next dog, a little black and white Lhasa Apso.
That little one is Pupcake. She's the easygoing one, and the boy's favorite.
He had her rolling onto her back in seconds. I pointed to the spotted brown coonhound.
That one is Coffee Cup. He's the youngest, and he and I are working through some issues.
He laughed at the name, stroking the dog,
Coffee cup licked his face, and he didn't bat an eye. Son of a bitch. Dare I ask about the issues, or is it a touchy subject?
It's touchy, I told him.
The wild dog was driving me up the wall bonkers lately, and I didn't want to explain all of the reasons why. I pointed at Dot, who was nuzzling into my dangling leg.
This is Dot. He's the guard dog of the bunch.
Tristan nodded, bending down to pet the dog, his hand not an inch away from my leg. Shockingly, Dot let him, his tail wagging, no snarl in sight, close proximity to me and all.
What the fuck? How did you do that? Dot never takes to strangers.
He wiggled his fingers at me. Haven't I told you? I have magic hands. I rolled my eyes. He straightened, pulling a pack of cards out of his pocket. I couldn't believe I hadn't noticed them. I'd been enjoying how he fit into his jeans rather intently. He shuffled the cards. I could tell by the way he handled them that he practiced a lot. His hands were big, which made the deft movements of his fingers more impressive and more distracting. He fanned the cards out, smiling at me.
Pick a card, any card.
I arched a brow at him sardonically.
Are we really doing this? Card tricks?
He nodded, his smile widening.
See, skeptics are my favorite.
So much more room to blow your mind. I rolled my eyes, but I picked a card, extracting it carefully, keeping it turned away from him. I almost rolled my eyes again when I saw that it was the Queen of Hearts.
I want a new card, I told him.
He just laughed, shaking his head.
Just memorize it and put it back.
I did, making sure he couldn't see it. He started shuffling the cards again, not even glancing down.
I've seen this trick before, I told him.
His brow furrowed, and the cards started shooting from his hands, going everywhere.
You have? He asked.
I nodded, uncertain if throwing the cards everywhere had been part of the trick. He whistled loudly.
Mango, bring her the card.
I glanced down at the dogs, totally lost.
What the?
Mango had a card in her mouth, and I bent down to her, holding a hand out.
Don't eat cards, silly. That's even worse than a stick of butter.
I trailed off as I pulled the Queen of Hearts out of her mouth. I straightened, thrown for a loop. I raised my wide eyes to Tristan's smug ones.
How on earth did you do that?
He wiggled his fingers at me again. His magic hands.
Jazz hands are hardly an answer, I told him.
That had him doubled over laughing, and me smiling, because I already loved the sound of his laugh.
Seriously, how did you do that? How in the world did you have Mango in on the trick?
Magic hands is the only answer you'll ever get out of me. So, can you still say you've seen that trick before?
I just shook my head, trying hard to figure out what all he had to have done to pull that off.
Those are some fun dog names.
He startled me out of my thoughts. I shrugged. The boys named all of them except for Mango. I thought they did a pretty good job. They're funny kids. I turned my head as Bev called my name, approaching the kitchen with a smile. She turned that smile on Tristan as she got close. She was a tall, slender woman with cornflower blue eyes and reddish blonde hair. She was 48. But I didn't think she looked it, her pale skin showing just the faintest signs of aging. Her features were attractive, her figure trim, and she was always dressed impeccably.
I'm so sorry, Danica, she told me. I didn't realize this was a friend of yours. I feel so rude, storming off without introducing myself. I thought he was another of Jerry's projects.
She swept her hand in the air, as though to wave the idea away. I didn't think I'd felt so shitty about myself in years as I did staring at the apologetic curve of her lips.
But anyway, she turned to Tristan, holding out her hand. I'm Bev.
Tristan didn't hesitate to smile back, taking her hand.
Tristan.
Bev looked at me. Jerry tells me you met him last semester. Why is this the first time hearing of it? She asked, smiling. Bev's smile was all open charm. No one in the world would have guessed she was a lawyer by that smile. I shrugged, feeling defensive and guilty as hell.
Nothing to tell. He's just a buddy. He'll only be staying for a week, I swear.
She waved that off.
Don't worry about it. Stay as long as you like, Tristan. Any friend of Danica's is a friend of mine. So, where and how exactly did you guys meet?
We had a class together, I answered, shooting Tristan a glance.
What class?
She asked, as persistent as you'd expect from an attorney.
Psychology,
I threw out.
English,
Tristan said at the same time. I shot him a very unfriendly look for contradicting me. He grinned at Bev, totally unfazed.
Both. We had two classes together, actually. Danica was nice enough to share her notes with me.
Bev shot me a fond look.
She is meticulous.
I smiled back at her, vowing to myself that I would never lie to her again, no matter the reason. Damn Jerry.
I was just trying to get Danica to go out to a club with me tonight,
Tristan told Bev. I blinked at him, wondering what the hell he was doing.
She seems to think that walking the dogs is what a 22-year-old should be doing for fun. I think she needs to get out more. Will you help me convince her?
Bev looked at me, her brow furrowing.
You know, Danica, I can't remember the last time you went out.
Tristan has a point.
You're 21. You should be having more fun.
If looks could kill, Tristan would have dropped dead on the spot. He'd managed to get my Bev on his side in under a minute. I couldn't quite believe it. He just smiled back at me, unfazed by my look of death.
It's settled then. We'll go out tonight. There's this new club at the Cavendish Casino. It's great. You'll love it.
I stared at him for a solid minute before I spoke.
You just want me to drive your sorry ass. You probably don't even have a car.
I felt a little silly as both Tristan and Bev began to laugh.
You two seem to know each other well, Bev gasped. How have I never heard a word about Tristan before this, Danica?
I shook my head, but Tristan spoke before I could. He put his hand over his heart, giving me a heart-stopping smile.
That hurts my feelings, Danica. Don't you ever talk about me?
He was enjoying this little charade, but I sure wasn't.
Nope,
I said curtly.
Oh, Danica, you have to go out. I insist. Go have a good time. I don't need any help with the boys tonight.
I grimaced.
I have things to do.
Like what?
Tristan asked.
Well, for one, I need to walk the dogs.
Okay, let's go do that now. I'll come with.
I rolled my eyes, fully realizing that I was acting like a 10-year-old.
Fine, but you have to walk Coffee Cup.
He shrugged.
Sounds great.
And I have to clean the pool,
I told him.
Oh, don't worry about it, Bev said.
I'll help,
Tristan said, being strangely persistent.
And I have to finish the laundry.
Tristan shrugged.
We'll get started after the cookies are done.
You don't have to do that today, Danica.
Bev tried again.
I can get to the laundry myself tonight, and the pool can wait. You could use a night off.
We'll knock those chores off in an hour, and she'll still have plenty of time to get ready,
Tristan said. The oven timer started to beep, and he went to check on his cookies. Bev and I just watched him, not saying a word, as he put on oven mitts and slid the cookie sheet out of the oven. It was a strange and riveting sight. A ripped man at home in the kitchen, baking fucking cookies. This man was so much trouble. He studied the delicious smelling cookies for a long moment, then gave me a sidelong smile.
A perfect batch. You two have to try these.
I curled my lip at him.
I'm watching my figure.
His eyes flicked shamelessly over my body.
And you're doing a damn fine job of it, but you can eat a cookie.
Who could turn that down?
Bev asked. Who indeed? I thought resentfully. He was too bossy for my taste. Or at least, I told myself that.
So, what chore do we need to tackle first?
Tristan asked, while he slid a few still hot cookies from the sheet and onto the plate.
Dogs,
I said absently, still distracted by his ease in the kitchen. He nodded, bringing the plate over to us.
The cookies will be cool enough to eat in a minute. You're eating one, and then we'll walk the dogs.
I reached for a cookie, completely enticed by the smell. I was usually really good about dieting since I had to maintain my figure for dancing, but even I couldn't resist the lure of his divine-smelling cookies. He swatted my hand away.
I said, 1 minute, Danica.
I glared at him for at least a solid minute. He only smiled. He offered the plate to Bev first. She took one, thanking him. I folded my arms over my chest and just looked at him. I was trying hard to talk myself into refusing to eat a cookie, just to spite him, the bossy son of a bitch. He flashed a dimple at me, his golden eyes filled with mirth, and had the utter nerve to grab one with his own hand and hold it up to my lips. I took a bite, the smell and his charm irresistible to me. I closed my eyes, groaning as I chewed. I heard Bev making a similar noise. The man was not all talk. His cookies were as good as he claimed. It was just the perfect flavor combination of salty and sweet, and the texture was perfect, not too gooey, but melt in your mouth soft. I barely had to chew. Finally, after taking my time with the first bite, I opened my eyes to look at him. He was still smiling at me, his hand still holding the cookie in my mouth for another bite. But there was heat in his eyes now. I grabbed the cookie out of his hand, taking another bite. He nabbed one for himself, taking a huge bite. I watched him chew, transfixed by the hard line of his jaw as it worked. Finally, I made myself look away, finishing my cookie with slow, savoring bites. The boys rushed the kitchen right as I was finishing, and Tristan handed them cookies and paper towels, introducing himself. He was at ease with the kids, and they seemed to take to him instantly, just like everyone else had. The man was like a charm grenade. I gathered the dogs' leashes from the laundry room, slipping into flip-flops and heading to the front door. Dot saw the leashes first and rushed to the door, tail wagging. Bev had a huge backyard, but the dogs still loved their walks. I got them all ready, intending to leave whether Tristan joined me or not. I didn't need help, and I didn't quite understand his need to keep me company for my chores. He caught up to me as I was slipping out the door, holding it open for me. He held a hand out to me as we got outside, and I handed him coffee cup and pupcakes leashes. We were just moving onto the sidewalk when he asked,
"So, tell me about your issues with coffee cup."
I sighed.
"Why?"
Why? Why on earth do you care about my dog issues?
Because I'm curious, and I think it's adorable that you have dog issues.
That drew a small smile and an answer out of me. He's rambunctious. He's made it his mission in life to try to rush out the front door every time I have to open it for any reason. He's gotten loose in the neighborhood 3 times this week. He shrugged.
It's a quiet neighborhood. It's not like there are cars speeding around here. It's gated. What's the big deal?
I grimaced. It's a big deal because of the chicken lady. That surprised a laugh out of him. The chicken lady? I laughed too, knowing how ridiculous it sounded, how ridiculous it was. Yes, the crazy chicken lady. He had to stop walking. He was laughing so hard. Okay, you have to tell me this story. What exactly is a crazy chicken lady? I shook my head, but I told him. Well, there's a community stable in the center of the neighborhood. Residents can rent out stalls. Most of the stalls are used for horses, but this one lady uses them for her prize chickens. He arched a brow. He had a way about him that was so hard for me to resist, especially the way he gave me every ounce of his attention with single-minded focus. I drank up that attention as though I'd been starving for it. I really needed to get out more. Prize chickens? He asked. Yes, she has prize chickens. She lives right by the stables and, as far as I can tell, spends most of the damn day there. She lets them roam the stables while she's there, so they're loose a lot of the time, completely unprotected. He started laughing again. Oh no, he said, seeing where the story was headed. I nodded. Oh yes, I've timed it. Coffee Cup can get to the stables in under 2 minutes, and nab a chicken just seconds after that. He's taken out 3 of her chickens just this week alone. Taken out? I nodded. He eats them. He has their necks snapped before I can catch up to him, and I'm a fast runner.
That's messed up.
Yes, I know. This is why Coffee Cup and I have issues. Crazy chicken lady goes ballistic on me when she loses a chicken. Bev has to pay her $50 every time it happens, but that's no consolation to crazy chicken lady, since the damn chickens are her life. We started walking again, but we were both smiling.
Well, if he gets loose while I'm around, I'll catch him before he can murder any chickens. I promise.
He's really fast, I warned, not believing for a second that he could catch the crazy dog if it got loose.
So am I.
I just shook my head, laughing. Chapter 3. We got through my chores in record time. Tristan even folded laundry with me. I thought he was bizarre, and really kind of sweet. Within short hours of meeting the strange man, I found myself rifling through my closet, looking for Vegas club gear. The dirty Vegas club scene was so not me, but I still found myself excited about going out. Tristan was just fun, and I was excited for fun. The candid conversation that had set us up as friends right off the bat eased any reservations I might have had about hanging out with someone like him. I didn't have a lot of friends my own age. I'd adopted most of Bev's circle of friends as my own, and besides myself, the youngest of them was 32. I felt comfortable with older people. I attributed that to Bev. Being around her had just always been so good for me, so safe. She was mature, and she always knew how to be healthy. She was stable, and I needed stability. I clung to it. And people my age living in Sin City rarely belonged in the same sentence with stability. I knew that Tristan was no exception. He likely didn't belong in the same book with stability, but still, he was hard to resist. I was staring at my closet full of clothes for a good 5 minutes when Bev found me. It was a well-stocked closet, thanks to Bev's frequent hand-me-downs. Thank God we wore the same size. And I couldn't complain, but I just wasn't sure how to dress. The Vegas nightlife was pretty diverse. I could get away with wearing jeans or go fully decked out. But I just couldn't decide what I wanted to do. I didn't want to look like a slob, but I really didn't want to look like I was trying too hard. Bev gave a brief knock on my door before she came in, her usual routine. She had a black silk halter dress draped over her arm. I recognized it as one she'd worn several times before. It was one of her favorites. It bloused out and banded at the hips,
I tried it on for fun once, and I knew it was flattering. In fact, it was gorgeous, but maybe too dressy for a club night out with a guy I barely knew. Still, I coveted that dress. I bit my lip, and she gave me a look.
If you wear this, I'll give you a free pass at anything you want in my closet at a future date of your choosing, she told me. Just like that, she had me. Her closet was mind-boggling and way above my pay scale.
Thank you, I told her. She smiled and winked at me, clearly pleased with my agreement. I showered and did my hair and makeup first, letting the steam from the shower smooth out any small wrinkles in the dress. The top was pure silk, held at the neck with Swarovski crystals. The fitted skirt was a silky-looking material, but it had elastic, so it had stretch, and I could still dance in it, which was a must. I didn't love to go clubbing, but I did love to dance. I eyed the way out of my price range dress as I blew out my hair, letting it fall straight, a black waterfall down my back. Black was always a good bet for me. It brought out my ivory skin and pale gray eyes. My mother was half Russian, half Japanese, and I supposed my features were a mix of both. That was only a guessing game, though, really, since I'd never known what the other side of that equation consisted of. I lined my eyes carefully in black and smudged a smoky dark gray shadow onto my eyelids. I was liberal with the mascara and used a dark maroon lip stain, but that was all. My skin tone didn't need and couldn't handle foundation. I was still wearing just a towel when Bev breezed into the bathroom with me. She and I hadn't had privacy boundaries for years, and I only smiled at her as she barged in on me after a cursory knock. I started shaking my head as soon as I saw the jewelry box in her hand. She didn't own any cheap costume jewelry, and I would be terrified if I borrowed something expensive and then lost it. The sad fact was I could never afford to replace even her cheapest piece of bling. She completely disregarded my head shake, opening the box to show me a pair of earrings. They were huge, pear-shaped diamond studs, 2 carats at least. They latch on tight, Danica. There's no way you'd lose one. And that dress begs for diamonds. I can't, Bev. I just can't. And I think I might already be overdressed. Tristan is probably just going to wear a t-shirt and jeans anyway. You're wrong there. I saw him. He's already ready and looking sharp. I smirked. I loved it when she went all old school on me. Sharp? Like a pencil? Sharp like dressed up, you smartass. What's he wearing? Black slacks and a blazer over a black t-shirt. Sounds a little Vegas douchey. The t-shirt with a suit, I mean. And isn't it a little hot for that? She shrugged. Wait until you see him. Call it whatever you want, but he looks edible. I laughed. I can't believe you're encouraging me to go out with him. Lucy will have a field day harassing you about it. Hell, she'll harass us both. Bev pursed her lips, and I grinned. Knowing that she was going to go into Lucy mode, she did a spot-on impression of our psychiatrist friend, Lucy.
Jumping from one relationship and straight into another is a symptom of your love addiction, Danica, she said, her voice pitched low.
I sighed. He really is just a friend. No funny business at all, but I doubt she'd believe that if she got a look at him. Bev nodded. I believe you, but I have a feeling she'll have something to say about it. I started getting dressed, completely unfazed by Bev's presence. I heard a big sigh behind me as I was slipping the dress over my head.
I'd give anything to have tits like that again. I have to tape mine up to wear that dress, I shit you not.
I laughed.
I remember. I helped with the tape. You looked fabulous, though, which is all that counts.
She grimaced.
I remember my braless days, though. Now that's fun. You're smarter than I was,
You rarely go without a bra. I never even owned one until my late 30s.
I shrugged. I was only a small C cup, but I didn't feel comfortable without a bra. The only time I went without was when a dress demanded it, and that rarely ever happened, since I hardly ever dressed up. I adjusted the dress around my hips, then straightened the neckline. It was one of those dresses that felt good and looked better.
"Your red shoes," Bev said. I nodded, knowing which shoes she was referring to. She'd given them to me after wearing them herself to four different events. They were open-toed stilettos with a 4-inch heel. I loved them, and though they weren't comfortable, they were hot, and I could dance in them fine, which was all that mattered. Bev tried to talk me into the earrings, but I held strong. This wasn't the prom, and I was already decked out. I felt like hot stuff as I strode out into the living room, but I stopped dead when I got a load of Tristan. If I was hot, he was scorching. The worst part was, I would have bet money it had only taken him minutes to get that way. His slacks and blazer were nice. I didn't know a thing about suits, but his looked expensive to me, and it fit him perfectly, hugging his build so that no one could doubt that he was buff. It looked like a custom suit, especially considering his size, though I couldn't have said for sure, and I found it unlikely since he was a club promoter. I was pretty sure that was one of those jobs that never had an actual paycheck. Black was his color, to be sure. It brought out his tan skin, handsome features, and his golden eyes. He hadn't shaved, but somehow the black stubble on his jaw and his short, black hair went just right with the suit. He looked sinister and drop-dead gorgeous. He grinned when he saw me, and I tried my hardest to stop checking him out. I already knew he looked good. I would only embarrass myself by ogling him. "I'd like to say several things," he began. "But since we're just being friendly, may I just say that you look very nice."
"Thank you," I told him, still trying hard not to check him out. He shifted, shoving his hands in his pockets, and my eyes went to his chest, fascinated with the way that the material pulled there.
"You look very nice, too."
His grin deepened, and his dimples made my own self-destructive music play at full volume in my head.
"You like to dance?"
"Oh, God, please say he doesn't dance," I thought. "Please, please, please, say he's not good at it."
"I do,"
I said, my tone flat. He wiggled his brows at me playfully.
"That's good. So do I. We'll have to see if you can keep up."
I folded my arms across my chest, arching a brow at him. "I can go all night." He touched a hand to his forehead, looking pained.
"Tease,"
he murmured, opening the front door for me. Either Bev or Jerry had been nice enough to shut the dogs in back, so they wouldn't be rushing the front door as we left.
"Am I driving?"
I asked. I didn't really want to drive my beat-up 98 Civic to the Strip, but I was pretty sure that was our only option, since Tristan had clearly driven to the house in Jerry's car.
"Nope."
He pointed to a black sedan that was idling at the curb.
"I'd hate to make the 21-year-old act as the designated driver. That's blasphemy. My friend is going to take us. He owes me a few favors."
He opened the back door of the car for me. I slid in, and he shut it behind me, climbing into the passenger seat. A skinny, brown-haired guy sat behind the driver's seat. He wore black-framed eyeglasses. He was handsome, in a hipster sort of way, with even features and dark eyes. I thought he could have been a year or two older than me. He flashed me a friendly smile as Tristan made introductions.
"This is Kenny. Our friends love nicknames, though, so we call him Pancakes."
"Pancakes?" I asked. Kenny rolled his eyes.
"It's stupid. We call him that because he's a nice guy. No matter how brief the hookup, he'll always make a girl pancakes in the morning." it was my turn to do some eye-rolling.
Aren't you a bunch of charmers?
Kenny grinned, and Tristan laughed.
What about you? I asked Tristan. You don't even make them pancakes?
If they're around in the morning, sure. I'm not opposed to cooking.
Do you have a nickname?
Tristan is the only name I answer to, he said.
Kenny shot him a wide-eyed look.
The guys call him Trist, like with a Y, but he hates it.
That's adorable, I said, instantly liking the way it made him glare. He was way too smiley most of the time.
Trist, a nice way to call you a man whore. I like it.
Tristan turned in his seat to look at me.
You are not allowed to call me that.
I shrugged at him, grinning. How on earth could you stop me? He grinned right back.
Trust me, I'll think of something.
Of course, that only made me curious about what he would do.
Sure thing, Trist, I told him. He shook his head. Don't make me get out of my seat.
What will you do?
He thought it over.
Let me try again. It's obvious threats only encourage you. If you can refrain from calling me that, I will cook you breakfast.
I don't like pancakes, I warned him.
I'll make you anything you want. Consider me your short-order cook.
Is this offer good for only one breakfast?
I'll make you whatever you want. Every morning I stay at the house.
Deal, I told him quickly. After tasting his cookies, I wanted whatever he was cooking.
But I'm very picky. You'll have your work cut out for you in the morning.
He just smiled.
I look forward to it. I'm going to blow your mind.
I crossed my legs, looking away, my mind veering far from the thought of food.
So you two aren't dating? Kenny asked Tristan, shooting him a glance.
We're not, but don't get any ideas. None of you knuckleheads are allowed to go near her. Spread the word.
What sort of caveman reasoning is that?
I piped in, agitated. I certainly had no intention of dating one of his obviously immature friends, but I sure as hell didn't think he should have a say in it. He flashed those damn dimples at me, so charming that I wanted to hit him over the head with my purse.
Just looking out for a friend. You're the relationship type. None of the guys you're going to meet are. I'm looking to save you a headache down the road.
How sweet, I murmured, wondering what I was getting myself into with this crowd.
We meeting all of these charmers tonight?
I don't know. Who will be there? Tristan said, looking at Kenny.
Kenny shrugged.
Who knows? Corey is working the bar, so my guess is there will be a turnout. Not many of our friends will turn down free drinks at one of the hottest clubs in town. But Jared is the only one I know for sure will be there.
Nice, Tristan said, sounding pleased.
Jared is my baby brother. You'll love him. Everybody does. You have any brothers or sisters?
A tight fist gripped around my heart at the question. I hadn't been expecting it, and it was a subject that my mind tended to shy away from.
I have a sister.
Older or younger?
She's 2 years younger than me.
She live in town?
I bit my lip.
I don't know. I haven't heard from her in years.
Why the hell not? You have to keep in touch with family.
If only it were so simple.
She hates me, actually. I couldn't get her to talk to me if I tried.
Why?
Because I'm a shitty big sister. Are we done with the interrogation?
My bad, I didn't mean to be nosy.
So don't be. Just drop it.
I felt bitchy. But being a bitch was better than rehashing painful old baggage just to appease his curiosity. He put his hands in the air to signal that he would stop. Even agitated, I couldn't help but study those big, sexy hands.
Sorry, he said, sounding sincere.
Sorry, I will drop it. To make up for being so rude, I'll pick up your tab for the night.
I gave him a level stare. You know the bartender. It was already going to be free, wasn't it? Those damn dimples came back in force. Even in the darkness of the car, I could see the twinkle in his golden eyes. Have I mentioned that I like sassy women? Yes, the tab was going to be covered either way. How about I help you with your chores while I stay at the house? Will that make up for me being so nosy? I studied him, knowing that, friends or not, being in close proximity to him for a prolonged period of time would not be good for my peace of mind. Still, I just couldn't seem to resist. I enjoyed being around him, trouble or no. It will. You're my chore bitch for the week, I told him. A happy smile overtook my face as he threw his head back and laughed.
She owns your ass, Kenny said, laughing.
Tristan gave me a sideways smile that could only be described as mischievous. I can think of worse things. Chapter 4. It was midsummer, and the air felt like a hairdryer as Tristan handed me out of the car.
You're kind of a gentleman,
for a man whore, I told him so only he could hear. That startled the laugh out of him.
I try,
he told me, not sounding at all offended. Kenny had valet parked, so we were inside of the Cavendish Casino in a few short steps. Cool air blasted me as we stepped inside, a stark contrast that had my nipples hard as rocks in a heartbeat.
Brr,
I said. That made Tristan steal a glance at my nipples. I heard the perverted bastard mutter, fuck, as he looked quickly away. Pervert, I said softly. Of course that made him smile. He grabbed my hand, pulling me with him as he started to walk at a fast clip across the marble of the grand foyer that led into the casino.
Slow down, I snapped at him. Have a little sympathy for a girl wearing 4-inch heels.
He glanced down at my feet, shaking his head.
I'm sorry. On behalf of men everywhere, thank you for wearing sexy fucking shoes. I'll try to remember not to walk too fast.
Thank you for not minding that I can be a pain in the ass, I told him, thinking how sweet it was that he was so accommodating.
On the contrary, I love that you tell me what's on your mind. I'm not good at guessing games, and I find it refreshing that you just tell me what you're thinking.
I hate sulking, Danica, and you're no sulker.
Give me shit, hell, yell and scream at me, just as long as you let me know where we stand.
I blinked at him, thrown for a loop. I can do that. I'm actually very good at that.
Yes, you are. I love that about you.
And I love that you love that about me, I told him, meaning it. And boy, did I. I loved a man that could take a little honesty. My ex had been a whiny bitch who was always protecting his fragile little ego, so my brand of honesty had never been the order of the day. Tristan was a nice change of pace, to say the least. I took in our fancy surroundings as we strode slowly through the casino portion of the Cavendish property.
Where did Kenny go?
I asked, as I noticed that the other man had disappeared.
Not sure, he said, looking around. He'll meet us at the club, though. It's not far.
Decadence, the club, was intimidating. There was a long line to the entrance as we approached. My first thought when I saw a line like that was to head in the other direction. I slowed, but Tristan just pulled lightly on my hand, heading straight for the front of the line. The huge, stern-looking bouncer didn't even check our IDs, just nodded us through the door, no expression on his face.
You know him?
I asked Tristan. He nodded, pulling me along. I found myself quickly distracted. The club was breathtaking. Long couches flanked numerous indoor pools that formed one large circle, a huge waterfall the center of it all.
Nearly every pool had its own bar. It was by far the most impressive club I'd ever seen. But one huge shortcoming stood out to me right away. "Where's the dance floor?" I asked him. He waved at the pools.
"This is the lounge, though you can sure as hell dance here if you want."
He pointed at a large arch that led into a darkened room.
"That's the dance floor. And as you can see, there are bars everywhere. We just need to find the one our friend Corey is working at to get hooked up with free drinks."
A few bikini-clad women frolicked in one of the nearby pools. They were giggling loudly enough to draw attention. "I didn't bring a swimsuit," I told him. He glanced at the pools, looking surprised at the idea.
"I didn't think of it. If you want to swim, I'll find us some suits. It's up to you. Let's get a drink, dance, and then decide."
"How are you ever going to find a random hookup if you spend all your time with me?" He just smiled.
"You let me worry about that."
I hadn't really been worried about it. Not at all, in fact. There was something about him, and it wasn't just his size, that seemed to command every room he walked into, even this one. Charisma, I thought. By the looks women were shooting at him, I knew that he wouldn't have to look hard to find anyone. Hell, showing up with a woman on his arm would probably only make him more appealing to this crowd. "Am I like your wingman tonight?" I asked, as a particularly bold blonde gave him a thorough once-over. He seemed to like that idea, his smile widening unabashedly.
"Wouldn't that be ironic?"
"Why is that ironic? Because I'm a woman?" His mouth twisted, and he stopped to study me.
"I'm not sure I should answer that. It's not a friendly answer."
"Well, now I have to hear your explanation. What's that supposed to mean?" He sighed.
"You asked for it. Don't say I didn't warn you."
He leaned in close, speaking into my ear. We were just outside of the room that held the dance floor, so it wasn't so loud that I couldn't have heard him. I thought he was just doing it for dramatic effect.
"It's ironic that I'd use you for my wingman when I want to fuck you more than any of the women here."
"Oh," I said, eyes wide on him as he pulled back.
"That was sweet, you silver-tongued devil,"
he laughed, and I couldn't help but join him. Those dimples and the clear admiration in his eyes were a potent and irresistible combination, and his shameless flirting didn't raise any red flags for me. On the contrary, I thought he was too much fun.
"What are we drinking, sweetheart?"
he asked, tugging me back the way we'd come.
"Hey, where are we going? I thought we were going to dance."
"I just spotted my friend at the bar over there. Time for some free drinks.
Ladies' choice."
"Something with tequila," I told him.
"Now we're talking."
We approached one of the bars near the club's entrance. A good-looking blonde male bartender grinned when he spotted Tristan, holding up his hand in a small wave after he'd handed two martinis off to a man in a suit.
"Hey, Corey," Tristan said as we drew close. "This is my friend Danica. Danica, this is my friend Corey. Tell him what you'd like to drink."
I shook the man's hand, immediately taking a liking to him. I thought that was because of his easygoing smile. He was handsome, but more than that, he just had one of those faces that made you want to like him at a glance, with kind eyes and a sweet smile. He was wearing a white dress shirt with the sleeves rolled up, and I could tell he was built. He was thinner than Tristan, but he still obviously spent some time at the gym. If I had been on the lookout for a man, which I emphatically wasn't, Tristan's friends would have been some prime candidates.
"Nice to meet you, Corey," I told him, not even having to raise my voice.
I thought that was something you must only get in the really nice clubs, since the ones I'd been to before I'd had to yell to be heard.
"Nice to meet you, Danica. What can I get you to drink?"
I shrugged, biting my lip. I wasn't a big drinker, so nothing specific came to mind right off the bat.
Something with tequila, I said.
Shots or cocktails to start?
He asked, looking between me and Tristan.
Let's start with a shot,
Tristan said, his hand going to the small of my back to usher me onto a padded, high-backed bar stool. We watched Corey as he mixed the shot. The only bottle I recognized was tequila.
What's he making us?
I asked Tristan.
Hell if I know. Something with tequila.
Corey made a production out of pouring the shots, sliding them to us with a smile.
Diablo shots.
I laughed.
That sounds ominous.
Corey wiggled his brows at me.
Oh, it is. Go for it.
You aren't having a shot with us? I asked him.
I'm working.
At a bar, I added. He didn't say another word, just grinned while he poured a third shot. He held it up to us in a toast.
This one is for the mysterious hottie on Tristan's arm tonight. You're a lucky bastard.
I glanced at Tristan, and we were both smiling as we took the shot. I just about choked as liquid fire went down my throat, but I got it down. Tristan laughed at the look on my face as I set the glass down.
You didn't like it?
I grimaced.
It was a shot. I didn't know I was supposed to like it.
I sure as hell felt it. Isn't that what matters? Corey answered, already busy pouring the next round.
Feeling it is the point. Good shit, right?
I nodded. I was already a little lightheaded, which meant that tiny shot had been pure alcohol. I watched Tristan's big hand as he picked up his refilled shot glass. He held it up. I grabbed my own, watching him.
Two sarcastic women who aren't afraid to tell it like it is,
Tristan said, holding the shot glass up to his mouth and tipping his head back. Oh, I like this one, I thought, watching his throat work as he swallowed. A sexy man who liked sarcastic women? I downed my own shot, blinking rapidly as it made my eyes water. I met Tristan's eyes.
I hope you're strong enough to carry me home if I get too blitzed. I'm not used to drinking like this.
He flashed me those dangerous dimples.
Sweetheart, I could carry two of you home.
I rolled my eyes, setting my shot glass down for another round.
I'll bet you've done that before.
Done what? He asked, looking thoroughly confused. Carried two women home. Tristan waved Corey off as he started to pour another shot.
I think that's enough shots for the moment. We'll take two margaritas on the rocks. Make mine a double. And one of your raspberry ones for her.
Make mine a skinny, I added.
No fucking way, Tristan interjected.
I shot him a look.
No fucking way, he repeated. You don't need a skinny anything. You, my dear, are skinny enough.
I glared. Are you saying I'm too skinny? He laughed.
No, I'm not. As determined as you are to take offense, I was giving you a compliment. You look great. As a matter of fact, you look amazing. You don't, however, look like you need to be counting calories.
Well, I look this way because I do count calories.
Well, give yourself a night off.
Corey was already sliding us the margaritas, and already buzzed, it was pretty easy to take his advice and just drink.
I'm feeling awfully pretty,
I told Tristan as I finished the glass. He choked out a laugh, setting down his own glass.
Well, you are pretty, so that's good.
It's a drunk thing. I know I'm drunk when I feel real pretty. What's your drunk feeling?
He thought about it for a moment, rubbing at that sexy stubble on his jaw.
I guess I know I'm really shit-faced when I start to think I'm invincible, or that I'm exempt from consequences. But yours sounds better. My new term for getting drunk has been officially changed to feeling pretty. Feeling pretty, huh?
Corey called out from behind the bar.
Don't think we won't be giving you shit for that one. Tristan shrugged, not looking at all bothered by the notion. Corey pointed to a spot behind us, and I turned to see Kenny approaching. There was a tall young man with black hair next to him, who looked uncannily familiar, though I had to study him hard for a minute to figure out why. It was only as Tristan rose and embraced the black-haired one that I realized that they must be related. The other man was much thinner than Tristan, though they were of a height. Tristan was grinning as he made introductions.
Danica, this is my little brother Jared. Jared, this is my friend Danica.
Jared smiled as he leaned in close to shake my hand. The dimples ran in the family, and Jared used them almost as lethally as Tristan did. His wrists were layered with black and silver bracelets, and I saw that his arms were inked with full sleeves that disappeared into the arms of his black t-shirt. The brothers definitely shared a love for tattoos.
Nice to meet you,
Jared said, and I saw the piercing in his lip as he spoke. You too, I told him.
How do you know my brother?
He asked, propping his arm on the back of my chair.
He's crashing at my boss's place. We met earlier today, actually.
It felt weird to say that. I felt like I'd known him for a lot longer than a day already.
Want to dance?
Jared asked.
Hey now,
Tristan said, throwing an arm around his brother's shoulder.
I've been waiting all night to dance with her. You don't just get to walk up here and cut in.
He was smiling as he said it, which let me know he wasn't serious. But serious or not, Jared backed off instantly.
Of course, bro, Jared said. It just seemed like a waste to me that she'd be sitting in here instead of dancing in there.
Tristan finished his drink and set the glass down hard on the bar. He shrugged out of his suit jacket, draping it over the back of his chair. I tried not to stare at the sight of him in his tight black t-shirt and the display of tattoos on his hard, muscled arms, but it was distracting.
By God, you're right, he declared. Let's go, Danica. We've wasted precious dance floor time drinking.
Chapter 5. Tristan didn't waste any time after that, pulling me straight into the chaos of the dance floor. House music was playing, which wasn't always my favorite, but I could work with it. Whatever the DJ was doing had a good beat, which was all I needed. I smiled as Tristan moved in front of me, facing me to dance. It was a mischievous smile, because I knew, just absolutely knew, that I was about to blow his mind. I didn't do the Vegas bump and grind thing that people called dancing. I was a trained dancer. I trained in ballroom, salsa, hip-hop, and club dancing. Hell, I'd even trained in belly dancing. Although my obsession was hands down ballroom, I had my club freestyle down to a science. I started with one little hair toss, just to get his attention. I raised my hands above my head and began my own scintillating version of a gyrate. The floor was crowded, but I had just enough room to work. I put one hand on his chest while I twisted my hips. He was dancing, and the man had some moves. But his jaw went a little slack when he got a load of mine. He recovered quickly, though, and swiftly made his best effort to keep up with me. I went for it, shaking, popping, stepping, and twisting. We danced until I felt sweat dripping down my spine. And then we danced some more. Tristan was right there with me the whole time, and as I laughed and spun and just let loose, I tried hard to identify what I was feeling just then. After a time, I realized that I was just having fun. I couldn't remember a time when I'd enjoyed myself more. I danced often to train and to stay in shape, but I never did it for fun. This was fun. Tristan was flirty, but he never crossed a line. Never brushed up in ways that a man might try if he was making a move on a woman. I felt a strong attraction to him. I think any woman would have. But I appreciated that he'd said friend, and he seemed to mean it. I wasn't sure even I could have resisted him if he'd been hell-bent on seduction. The house music melded from one beat into the next, heavy on the bass. I couldn't tell how many songs we danced for, but I was a sweaty, happy, hot mess by the time Tristan finally dragged me back into the lounge.
I win. You quit first, I told him.
He sent me a sidelong smile. Was it a competition? I didn't know. Let's just get a drink before we head back out. I'm nowhere near quitting. The guys were just where we'd left them, and Corey slid us waters as we walked up.
Shots, Tristan said.
Corey grinned.
More Diablo coming right up.
How long were we out there? I asked Jared.
A long time, he said, checking the faceplate on his phone. Over 2 hours.
I laughed, grabbing my water for a long drink. I'd known we'd been out there for a long time, but I'd never have guessed 2 hours.
My turn?
Jared asked, watching me with a very interested glint in his eye.
Hell no,
Tristan answered for me.
Danica and I have a competition going tonight. We're dancing till one of us drops.
I had no problem with that. I had a competitive nature, and I just knew that I'd be winning. You do realize that I can't carry you home. All four men laughed, and I'd have been lying if I said I didn't enjoy the attention of four good-looking men. Corey slapped 5 shots down on the bar, and we shot them. I'd barely set my glass back down before Tristan was dragging me off again. We were back at it the instant we stepped out on the floor. I could tell right away that he was feeling more flirtatious this time, moving closer to me, his hand at the small of my back. You making a move on me? I called out to him, but I wasn't pushing him away. I was relieved when he shook his head. His smile was innocent enough, but I thought there was a hint of something else in his eyes.
Just dancing, sweetheart.
I dropped low, really low, and shook my way back up, my hand just brushing his thighs as I rose.
You making a move on me?
He called out with a laugh. I shook my head at him, giving him a wide-eyed, innocent look. Just dancing, sweetheart.
It was on after that. He'd caress my hip. I'd counter that by a turn and an extra little arch of my back, just brushing up against him.
He'd curse loudly, but we kept dancing. I was actually giggling when he finally pulled me back into the lounge. I couldn't remember the last time I'd giggled.
I'm conceding, but only because I think you'd go until we both passed out, just to prove a point,
Tristan told me as we walked.
All I heard just now was blah, 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 Danica wins.
He stopped, shaking his head and laughing.
I like you, he told me.
I wrinkled my nose at him.
I like you too, platonic friend of mine.
We were both grinning like fools as we rejoined the group. Corey served us another round. Kenny and Jared immediately started making cracks when they saw that Tristan was drinking a margarita.
He drinks those to feel pretty, Corey made sure to add. True story. Real men don't drink margaritas, Jared told me, waving his bottle of beer.
I pointed at the bottle. That will give you a beer gut. Jared grinned, lifting up his shirt to show me some very nice abs.
Hasn't been a problem so far.
I was a little too tipsy not to give him a very big smile for the very nice show. Tristan slapped a hand onto his brother's shoulder, leaning in to say something in his ear. Whatever it was, wiped the smile from Jared's face. He let his shirt drop.
Give us a minute,
Tristan said, moving a few feet away. They had a short, hushed conversation before returning to us. Tristan's face was very blank, but Jared's looked slightly flushed, perhaps with temper.
So, are you in this band that Tristan claims to be in?
I asked Kenny.
Kenny beamed at me. Yes, I am. All four of us are, plus one of our buddies who isn't here tonight.
What kind of music do you play? I asked.
Rock.
I wasn't surprised in the least.
So, who plays what?
I'm bass, Jared is lead guitar, Corey is drums, Tristan is lead vocals, and our friend Dean is rhythm guitar.
I shot Tristan a look. Gee, the lead singer of a rock band. I'm shocked.
I never would have guessed.
Sarcasm dripped from every word. He seemed to find that funny, which was good. I'd much rather have him think I was funny than be offended by my sense of humor.
So when and where do I get to see you play? I asked, turning back to Kenny.
Kenny's brow furrowed.
I'm not sure. Dean is setting up some gigs for us. Of course you're invited, whenever that happens.
So what are your day jobs? I asked, figuring they all had to have one.
As you've seen, Corey is a bartender, and I'm a valet parker on the weekends here. Our friend Dean is a blackjack dealer, and Tristan and Jared are both in the club promoting business.
They get paid to party, Corey added.
I couldn't seem to keep my 2 cents in. All I think when I hear club promoter is drug dealer or unemployed.
Jared grimaced.
Tristan just laughed.
You're coming to the next club party I host, he said, pointing at me.
I shrugged, giving him a sassy look.
Don't threaten me with a good time. All four of them seemed to find that hilarious. I flushed with pleasure. I could get used to this kind of attention, especially since it was coming from four hot guys.
Danica works for Jerry, Tristan told them.
We love Jerry, Kenny said.
She's the nanny, Tristan added.
Holy shit,
Jared muttered.
Did not see that coming, Corey called out, his back to us as he mixed a drink.
Not what I was expecting, Kenny mused.
Why is that so surprising to everyone? I asked, baffled that all four of them had had the same reaction to my being a nanny.
I had you pegged for a model, Jared said.
Tristan loves to date models, Corey called out.
Fuck off, Tristan told him.
We're not dating, I stated firmly.
I would have guessed dancer, Tristan told me, as though he hadn't just told Corey to fuck off.
Typical guys.
I pointed at Tristan. This round goes to Tristan. I'm a full-time student and a nanny, but I am an aspiring dancer. Not that I ever have the time.
I returned his smile, utterly charmed by it.
And the model thing is very flattering, guys, but I'm a little short for that.
Not for Vegas modeling, Jared pointed out.
You're what, 5'8"? Kenny guessed. That's tall enough.
I'd guess she's 5'7", Tristan mused. And she is tall enough, but I'm betting she's never even tried modeling, especially of the Vegas variety.
Not your scene, right?
I curled my lip at him.
You don't know me that well. Quit pretending like you're an expert.
Am I wrong? His brows shot up with the question.
You're not, I grudgingly admitted.
I blamed the alcohol when he gave me a smug smile, and my reaction was to stick my tongue out at him. He grabbed my hand, pulling me back out of my chair.
Just for that, we're going for another round on the floor.
You're a glutton for punishment, I told him, but I followed easily enough. The music had changed to Top 40 remixes, and something slow and sultry with a heavy beat had overtaken the room.
Uh-oh, I thought.
My eyes narrowed on his as he pulled me flush against him, sliding one sneaky knee between mine.
What are you doing?
I asked pointedly.
Just feeling the music? What happens on the dance floor stays on the dance floor. And I really am just dancing with you. I swear.
I can live with that, I thought, moving against him, letting the music take me over for another intoxicating spell. We danced close, but he still didn't cross any lines. We kept our lower regions very carefully apart, though our chests rubbed together more than once. I didn't know what it said about me, or my previous relationships, but I didn't think I'd ever been more turned on in my life as I was just from dancing with Tristan. My breath came out in little pants, every inch of my skin overheated, and not just from exertion.
You're absolutely positive that you don't hook up? Not even one really awesome night together before we settle down to being friends? His voice was a rasp in my ear that made me shiver from head to toe. I shook my head with no hesitation. It wasn't that I wasn't tempted. I just knew that I would feel like shit in the morning if I did something like that. I wasn't someone who could handle sex without commitment. I never had been. I'm positive, I said into his ear. No friends with benefits either? He asked, hopefully. The friends with benefit thing never works. He pulled back to meet my eyes. I agree, he said, though he didn't look happy about it. That never works. Someone always ends up getting hurt. Sorry, I just lost my mind for a second. That was an asshole thing to say. It's okay. Just don't let it happen again. I smiled while I said it, and there was no anger behind the words. I just wasn't sure how many times I could tell him no and mean it. I wanted him, and I wasn't dense enough to deny it to myself. I'll try my best, he murmured. Chapter 6. I knew before I'd even opened my eyes that I had a raging hangover. You couldn't go from hardly ever drinking to losing count of your drinks in one night and not feel it. And Lord, did I feel it. I checked the clock and groaned out loud when I saw that it was 7 a.m. That's how I knew that my hangover was truly heinous. It had woken me up after only 3 hours of sleep. I sat up, reaching for the glass of water I kept on my nightstand. I drank the entire glass, even though drinking was the last thing I wanted to do, because I knew that getting rehydrated was the best way to recover from the hangover. Dot, who'd been sleeping in his own doggy bed near the foot of mine, moved to my feet. He put his head on his paws and looked up at me. I couldn't decide if he was giving me a sympathetic look or a condescending one. My door opened, and Matt peeked his head inside, grinning.
Good morning, Boo,
he said, using the nickname he'd given me when he was 4.
Morning, Pika,
I told him, using my own nickname for him. Matt was always the first one awake, but everyone else quickly followed, usually due to the noise he managed to make.
Everybody else is still sleeping,
he said, in a whisper that managed to be louder than outright speaking.
I figured,
I said with a rueful smile. He always woke me up first, since I cooked breakfast.
What you want for breakfast?
Blueberry pancakes, please,
he nearly shouted. I winced and held up a hand. Coming right up, but I'm going to need you to stay nice and quiet this morning, okay?
Got it,
he said in a slightly quieter voice.
Will you turn on cartoons while I wait for my food?
Of course, bud. I just need to go to the bathroom, then I'll be right out.
I used the restroom and made my way to the living room, Dot dogging my steps. Matt was sitting on his kid-sized couch on the floor, Pupcake in his lap. He was staring in confusion across the room, and as I stepped into the room, I saw why. I padded quietly across the floor, switching on the TV and finding a channel with some cartoons. Matt fixated on the television, and I walked over to the shirtless hunk of a man that was sprawled out on the sofa. I was so fuzzy-headed that I'd forgotten he was even crashing here. He was lying on his back, a pillow pulled over his face, and another one draped over his lap. He'd completely kicked off his thin blanket. I could just make out that he was at least wearing boxer briefs, which was good, but the rest of him was all tanned, bared, tattooed skin. Not good, I thought, taking him in. I'd had no doubts that he would look good naked, and I certainly didn't need to see just how good. Even at rest, I could see the hard ridges in his abdomen and his arms. Jesus, his arms were huge, which was kind of a thing for me. I thought they might have been bigger than my waist, and for sheer perverse reasons, I wanted to measure them to see if I was right. And the tattoos, God, the tattoos. I didn't have a bit of ink, but I loved his. He didn't have full sleeves like his brother, but he wasn't too far off. His arms were covered with intricate designs, and it wasn't all black either. I loved all the color. It stood out startlingly against the other black ink, as though the black was just there to frame the color. I told myself it was totally unnecessary as I reached out and touched his bare shoulder. I nudged him, and if I enjoyed the feel of his muscular flesh, what was the harm? Tristan? I said quietly, nudging him again. My hand stayed there, and I tried to shake him a little, but he was too big for that. He started, pulling the pillow off his eyes and blinking up at me.
Fuck, Danica, it's early.
He said a bad word, Boo,
Matt called out, clearly affronted.
Fuck, sorry,
Tristan said, then winced. I couldn't hold back a grin. You can use my bed to sleep it off. This living room is about to turn into a war zone, and I need to make some blueberry pancakes.
Is that what you want for breakfast?
He asked, sitting up. I backed away like he was on fire, which he kind of was.
Huh?
I asked him, totally distracted by the sight of that perfect body, practically naked, and moving around. I went to the gym often, and I stayed in good shape myself, but I didn't think I'd ever seen a body so perfect in my life. He stood up, and I took another step back. He started to move around the couch, and something he was doing finally snapped me out of my trance.
Why are you still holding a pillow over your lap?
I asked. He sent me a wry smile, bending down to pick up his duffel bag, which he'd set behind the couch.
Can't you guess? I'll give you a hint. The first word is morning, and the second rhymes with hood.
I blushed, feeling stupid.
Oh, well, you can use my bathroom, and you can stash your bag in there so it's not in the way.
Okay, thank you. Just give me 5 minutes and I'll cook breakfast for everybody. I waved him off.
Go back to bed, I've got it.
I know you must be feeling rough. He sent me a rather stern look.
Give me 5 minutes. I said I'd cook for you, I'm cooking. And you have to be feeling just as rough.
I'm fine. I've got this. He pointed at me.
Don't go near the kitchen until I get back.
He strode away, and I made a face at his retreating back, though I was secretly pleased and still shamelessly checking him out. I'd seen what he could do with cookies. I wanted more. Normally, I just had a Greek yogurt for breakfast, but hungover and hungry, I was already planning to indulge. I sat down on the couch when I heard the shower in my bathroom turn on. There was plenty that I needed to do, but I just sat there for a solid 5 minutes, my mind on Tristan in the shower. He was back out quickly, wearing a fresh white t-shirt and jeans, his short hair still wet from his shower.
Come keep me company while I cook,
he said, tugging me up from the couch.
So bossy,
I muttered. He completely ignored that statement, pulling me into the kitchen. He cupped my hips, lifting me onto the counter exactly where I'd sat to watch him bake cookies. He moved away before I could do more than gape at him.
So, Matt wants pancakes for breakfast. What do you want?
I opened my mouth to tell him that I'd just take that, but he spoke again.
I know you don't want pancakes. We need something salty and greasy. Let me whip us up some hangover food.
I had to make a conscious effort to close my mouth.
You read my mind, I said.
He had the sheer gall to wink at me.
No, I've just been hungover enough to know just what to do.
So tell me why Matt called you Boo. Is that a nickname?
Yes.
I didn't elaborate.
That's adorable,
he said, opening the refrigerator and studying its contents.
Where did it come from?
I don't remember when it turned into an actual nickname, but we used to play peekaboo a lot. He named himself Pika and me Boo, and it stuck. 2 years and counting.
Well, Boo,
How does bacon sound?
Bacon sounds great, but you can't call me Boo.
Why not?
Because you're not a rapper, and I'm not your shorty.
He laughed, a low, deep rumble that made muscles in my stomach tighten.
You're just making me like the nickname more.
Here's the plan. Buttery biscuits, scrambled eggs, bacon, and some hash browns. Oh, and some blueberry pancakes for the kids. Any objections?
That sounds amazing, I said, meaning it.
But it'll take forever.
He shrugged.
It'll take how long it takes. What's the rush? You got a date?
I sighed. He was stubborn, to be sure.
Can I help?
You can entertain me while I work.
If you have this handled, I should probably go work on some chores.
If you want bacon, you'll keep your ass right where it is while I cook you breakfast.
I did want bacon.
I can't believe we stayed out that late, I said, thinking back to the night before. I'd never stayed out that late dancing, and I'd never had a night fly by so fast.
We going again tonight?
Are you joking? I asked.
No. Didn't you have fun? Let's do it again.
You're batshit bonkers.
Sure am. And I want to take you dancing again. What do you say?
We barely got 3 hours sleep last night.
So we'll take turns getting naps in later, if the kids need watching. What do you say?
He was giving me his most irresistible smile, his dimples making me want to slap and or kiss him senseless. I held out for maybe 5 seconds before I was smiling back at him.
No funny business, I told him.
No funny business, he agreed.
I took care of that in the shower. Should tide me over for a solid 2 hours.
I blushed. I hadn't even known I had any blushes left in me.
What happens after 2 hours?
He stopped what he was doing, setting an egg down to give me his full attention. He gave me a once-over that was borderline indecent, then went back to cracking eggs.
I might need to take another shower.
That shut me up for a while. I watched him work, studying the myriad of tattoos on his arm and the ones that showed through his white t-shirt. As he mixed the pancake batter, the stark muscles in his arms working, I thought that I'd found my new favorite hobby, watching Tristan cook anything at all.
Bev has this really great frilly pink apron, I told him. What would I have to do to get you to wear it while you cook for me?
You don't even want to know, Boo, he said. That effectively shut me up again. Within 10 minutes, he had the kitchen smelling divine. I moaned as the aroma of sizzling bacon reached me. His gaze flicked to me, then quickly away.
Tease,
he muttered. He had the pancakes done first, prepping a heaping plate for Matt.
You realize that he's 6, right?
I asked, eyeing up the huge plate.
Does he like bacon?
He asked, ignoring my comment.
Yes!
Matt shouted from the living room. Tristan handed off the plate, and I brought it to Matt in the living room. Bev didn't care if they ate on their little couches. The dogs always picked up any scraps they happened to leave behind. By the time I got back into the kitchen, Tristan had a biscuit breakfast sandwich waiting for me. He handed it to me with a paper towel, then took a huge bite out of his own. The smell of the eggs and bacon had me salivating, and I tore into the sandwich. I had to close my eyes with the first bite, chewing very slowly to savor every second of it.
What do you do to food to make it taste this good?
I moaned. I opened my eyes when he didn't answer me. He was staring at me with a look in his eyes that made my toes start to curl. He set down the uneaten half of his sandwich, striding out of the kitchen.
Where are you going?
I called to him.
I'll be back in 5 minutes,
he called back. I wasn't sure if I was pleased or appalled when I heard the shower turning on.
Chapter 7. Tristan. I turned the shower on, giving myself a good berating while I stripped down and got inside. I'd never been the guy that had to have a girl just because she was a challenge. I hated that guy, in fact. I usually thought that guy was a douchebag with little to no redeeming qualities. I like to keep sex in a separate category from all other parts of my life. Things just worked better that way, for all parties involved. I didn't do the girlfriend thing, and the fuck buddy thing was full of landmines. So why couldn't I stop thinking about being inside of Danica? She'd been crystal clear about the fact that she didn't do the casual thing, and now that we were officially friends, that was off the table anyway. But God, the body on her, and that face. She was one of the most beautiful women I'd ever seen, and she didn't even wear makeup half the time. And she walked around in a skin-tight tank top and tiny shorts, confident about her body in a way that drove me wild. I even thought her personality was sexy. She didn't put on airs. She never tried to play it cool. She let me know what was on her mind before I had to wonder. I'd spent years dealing with chicks who thought it was cool to keep a guy guessing. I was fed up with that shit. Danica was like a breath of fresh air. A breath of fresh air that I didn't get to fuck. If I'd been smart, I would have found a quick hookup the night before at the club. Then I wouldn't be stuck jacking myself off in the shower every time Danica looked at me funny. Yes, I definitely should have found a quick hookup last night, I thought yet again. That was what I normally did at clubs. I'd never spent 5 hours dancing with a girl that I knew for a fact I wouldn't get to sleep with. I stroked my rock-hard cock, thinking about her rosebud mouth and her striking gray eyes. And her shapely little body. Her waist was so tiny I could have spanned it with my hands. But she had the sexiest curves, and the way she walked. I could have guessed she was a dancer just by the way she swung her hips as she moved. Even her voice made me hard. She had a soft, steady voice, her tone even, as she gave me shit about whatever she pleased. I fisted my cock hard, stroking once, twice, 3 times, before coming hard into the air. It would have been embarrassing how fast I got myself off, if there'd been anyone else there to witness it. I thought I'd gotten it out of my system until I walked back out into the living room and saw her bending over in those damn tiny shorts. Fuck me. Was I in some trouble? We didn't end up having to take turns taking naps, since Bev took the boys out for the afternoon. We both crashed for 3 hours, me on the couch, and Danica on her bed. I ended up cooking everyone enchiladas for dinner, just to watch the look on Danica's face as she tasted them. When I'd realized that I couldn't move into my new apartment for a few weeks, even though the lease on my old apartment was already up, I hadn't known things would turn out like this. Still, I wasn't complaining. I couldn't remember a time when I'd had more fun. I wore a dark collared shirt and jeans for our night out. Few clubs were as strict with their dress code as the Cavendish Resort, and Corey wasn't working, so we couldn't afford to go to Decadence. Danica came out in tiny black satin shorts and a crimson blouse that hugged her breasts in a way that made my mouth water. She was wearing the same fuck-me heels she'd had on the night before, and it was official. She had killer legs. Fucking A, I said, not bothering to watch my language since the boys were already in bed.
You're not so bad yourself,
she said, tossing her hair as she gave me a sassy grin.
Is Kenny our chauffeur again?
I nodded. Let's wait outside for him. If he had to ring the bell, that might wake up the boys. And then there might be hell to pay. It was a bit of a challenge to get out of the front door without the dogs getting loose, but Danica managed it like a pro.
So, you don't have a house or a car?
She asked, as we made our way to the curb to wait for Kenny. I smirked. She didn't pull punches, that was for sure. I have a car. I loaned it to a buddy who needed to drive to L.A. for a few days. That was nice of you, she said. I shrugged. It's not a big deal, especially since I have friends like Kenny who will drive me around.
Kenny is a sweetheart, she said,
sounding like she meant it. I felt my jaw clenching, though I knew it was unreasonable to be jealous. He's a guy in a band. Don't trust any of us, I warned, my voice harsher than I'd intended. She shrugged.
You all seem safe enough to me, as long as I'm not stupid enough to date any of you.
I felt a wave of relief at her dismissive tone. Exactly. We ended up going to a club that, ironically enough, was called Tryst. I shot Danica a warning look when Kenny told us where we were headed. The look said, "Say a word, and I won't cook you breakfast again." She seemed to get the point, but her grin was infuriating.
"You getting us free drinks at this place?"
she asked. "Yes," Kenny answered. "Our buddy Doug is working one of the bars tonight."
"Do you have connections at every club in town?" she questioned.
"Just about," Kenny conceded. "When you're trying to promote a local band, you tend to get to know a lot of the people working the clubs."
"I'm sure it doesn't hurt that you guys seem to go out every night, too,"
she shot back. Tryst was packed. Still, the bouncer at the door recognized us on sight and let us in with one small nod. Getting in was always half the battle. We found Doug at one of the main bars in the club. He nodded when he saw me, waving me over. His bar was so packed I had to shoulder my way in.
"Got you guys a table," he said into my ear, voice pitched low. "And bottle service. It's your lucky night."
I grinned. "Thanks, man."
"Sure thing. It's not like you've never hooked me up. Who's that fucking hottie you walked in with?"
My grin wilted a little. "My friend, Danica. She's off limits." He sighed.
"All the ones that look like that usually are."
A VIP hostess showed us to our seats, courtesy of Doug. She was cute, and shot me some very inviting looks. I smiled, not really considering it. I'd invited Danica out to dance, and by God, we were going to dance, even if I was jonesing for a hookup. Danica gave me a mischievous smile as we slid onto the cushioned VIP bench.
"So where did you learn to cook like that?" she asked. "Those were the best enchiladas I've ever had, and enchiladas are one of my favorites."
I smiled, thinking of my mother. "My mother taught me to cook. You should try her enchiladas. They put mine to shame, especially since I was missing some of the ingredients for pico on top."
"Does she live here in Vegas?"
"Yes. In fact, I'm due for a family dinner soon, and I'm going to make you come with me." Her eyes widened.
"You want me to meet your parents?"
My face stiffened a little, but I didn't let it show. It couldn't be a sore subject if I didn't allow it to be. "I want you to meet my mother. I've never met my father." He left the second my mother told him she was pregnant, never bothered to look him up. She nodded, her eyes searching my face. She swallowed.
"We're in the same boat, my friend. I have not a clue who my father is. My mother would never tell me a thing about him."
I blinked, a little taken aback. It was selfish, but I felt comforted by the thought that she and I both experienced something so painful. It made me feel less alone, and so connected to her in ways I couldn't remember being connected to anyone besides family, since I could remember. "No wonder we get along so well," I finally responded. "We have more in common than we'd realized. Is your mother in Vegas too?" She shrugged, one side of her mouth jerking down.
I'm not exactly sure. She and I never really got along. We don't keep in touch.
I'd learned my lesson when I'd asked her about her sister, so I didn't ask her why on earth she didn't know where her mother was, though I was curious as hell about it. So, what's a good day for you to come meet my mother? She smiled, the clouds in her silver eyes clearing.
So you're not asking, but telling me, that I'm going to meet your mother.
I gave her a rueful smile. I'm letting you pick the day, at least. You have nothing to worry about. You two are going to love each other.
If she's anything like you and Jared, I can't imagine we won't get along.
That brought my mind to my baby brother. It didn't matter that he was an adult. He'd always been my baby brother. I'd have done anything for him, anything at all. But I knew that he was a little upset that I'd told him that he couldn't ask Danica out. We had very strict brother rules about dating the same woman, but since I wasn't dating her, he thought it was unfair that I'd warned him off. Still, whether he understood it or not, I thought he'd respect my wishes. The waitress brought out our bottle service, and I saw Danica's eyes widen. I made a note to myself that I owed Doug big time.
I'm impressed. Grey Goose Bottle Service. You've got some pretty good connections for a homeless guy.
I laughed, already mixing dirty martinis for us. Just how dirty do you want this? I asked, wiggling my eyebrows suggestively. That surprised a giggle out of her, and I thought that was my favorite sound. It was just so uncharacteristic for her, and I loved to be the cause of it.
I'll take it as dirty as you can dish it out.
I felt myself growing hard. She'd gotten the better of me, yet again. We had two drinks before hitting the floor. I was a good dancer, but I had absolutely nothing on Danica. The girl could move, and her dancing wasn't just about the sexy. I thought that every move she made was filled with talent and beauty. It was a top 40 dance mix tonight, and she knew the words to every song, frequently matching her moves to the words in cute little ways, flipping her hair, or holstering air guns at her sexy-as-hell hips. I bummed a cigarette off Kenny when I saw him where he was chatting up some guy in the corner. "Do you mind if I smoke?" I asked Danica as I returned to our table. She was looking at her phone, but she glanced up briefly to shake her head. She didn't look happy. "It's not a habit," I reassured her as I lit up. "I only smoke when I drink." She laughed.
"Well, from what I can see, you drink every night. How is that not a habit?"
I smiled ruefully. She did have a point. "Who are you texting?" I asked, trying to get a look at the screen on her phone. Her lip curled in distaste.
"No one important. My ex won't leave me alone. But I've learned not to text him back, even if it's just to tell him to go to hell."
I felt a totally unreasonable surge of anger move through me at that. "Want me to kick his ass?" I asked, not even close to joking. She laughed, shaking her head as she put her phone back into her tiny clutch.
"No, he'll give up eventually."
"What did his text say?" She rolled her eyes.
"He says he loves me, but he sure didn't love me enough not to cheat on me."
My gut clenched and my fists curled. "How long ago was that?" She made a dismissive motion with her hands.
"Almost a month now."
My eyes widened. "You haven't even been broken up for a month?" I couldn't have said exactly why, but that bothered me. A lot.
"We're ancient history, as far as I'm concerned. One strike and you're out. I don't know if it was the first time he cheated on me, but it was the first time I caught him, and once was enough for me.
I wouldn't take him back if he were the last man on Earth. If he caught fire and I had a glass of water, I'd drink it slowly and watch him burn, done. Even out of sorts, I had to stifle a laugh at that visual. I heard the faint